Assalamu alaikum. This is the last group of anti-Parkinsonian drugs, acetylcholine blocking drugs or anti-muscarinic drugs. The drugs are bipyridine, benztropine, orphenadrine, procyclidine, and trihexyphenidyl. These agents, anti-muscarinic drugs, they may improve the tremors and rigidity of Parkinson's, but have a little role or effect on bradykinesia. So the drug that is effective for bradykinesia is levodopa. So these drugs, anti-muscarinic drugs, they have been discussed in detail in ANS. So only the portion that is related to Parkinsonism is discussed here. So the anti-muscarinic drugs that are used in treatment of Parkinsonism are listed here. And their effect, that they have effect on tremors and rigidity, but have little effect on improving the bradykinesia that is associated with Parkinsonism. Now, these are the different other strategies through which we can treat Parkinsonism besides the pharmacological therapy, that the Parkinson's disease can be treated by surgical procedures. There is stimulation of subthalamic nuclei or globus pallidus is done by the implanted electrodes. And the second method that is, was done in controlled trials is that transplantation of the dopaminergic tissue, the fetal dopaminergic tissue in young ones, but this is not practiced in old ones, and this has not been beneficial in old patients. Another therapy is the neuroprotective therapy, and one of the drug has already been discussed, that is resigeline, which has this role, neuroprotective role, by scavenging the free radicals like MPP. Because one of the cause of Parkinsonism is through neurotoxins like MPTP. Gene therapy is another method, and this, through this method, the survival of dopaminergic neurons, it is increased. So these are some other methods besides the drugs for treatment of Parkinson's. Now, this is again the review of the lectures on anti-Parkinsonian drugs. Match the drugs in column A with their adverse effects in column B. So drugs mentioned are levodopa, amantadine, tolcapone, apomorphine, and pergolide. Levodopa, it is matched with on and off phenomena. So levodopa leads to fluctuation response with passage of time. Its effects are reduced with a passage of time, so it can lead to on and off phenomena. Amantadine, it leads to libido reticularis. But this libido reticularis, which is a lace-like discoloration of skin or mottled or purplish skin, occurs during usage of this amantadine. This libido reticularis, this clears off after a month or a few weeks of stoppage of amantadine. talk upon, which is one of the COMT inhibitor inhibiting both central as well as peripheral COMT, it can cause deranged liver function tests. Apomorphine, which is a drug dopamine receptor agonist, and it has a role and it is used in treatment of rescue therapy of off periods of akinesia, but on the initial phases of administration of this apomorphine, it can cause a severe nausea. So to prevent this nausea caused by apomorphine, anti-emetic drugs should be given prior to apomorphine. Pergolide, it is a ergot derivative and it can cause erythromelalgia. Erythromelalgia, it is characterized by the red nodules or redness mainly in feet. Other associated features of this erythromelalgia are redness and burning in feet. It also causes pain in feet. So these are some of the important adverse effects that are associated with these anti-Parkinsonian drugs. The levodopa, its adverse effects and the mechanism behind the adverse effects of levodopa plus the treatment of its adverse effects are also important. For example, levodopa, it can affect the CVS system, GIT, CNS, and it can also lead to dyskinesia as well. So the CVS side effects, postural hypotension and arrhythmias, and the GIT, including nausea, vomiting, they can be decreased by adding carbidopa to levodopa. And the GIT side effects can be reduced by increasing the daily dose of dopamine slowly by giving the levodopa in divided doses. Or we can also reduce these GIT side effects of levodopa by giving antacids prior to this drug. So the other side effects that are associated with levodopa are the behavioral effects, including hallucinations and delusions, and the dyskinesias for which amantadine is used. On and off phenomena, that is mentioned here, and end of dose akinesia, that is related to the dosage timing of levodopa. Match the drugs in column A with their mechanisms in column B. So bromocriptine, it is one of the drug that is agonist of D2 receptors. So this is agonist of D2 receptor. Bromocriptine is matched with this drug. Entacapone, it is one of the COMT inhibitor. But you can mention here the peripheral COMT inhibitor. So entacapone is COMT inhibitor, peripheral COMT inhibitor. Sledgeline, it is monoamine oxidase B inhibitor. So sledgeline can be matched with this. So by inhibiting monoamine oxidase B, which usually metabolizes dopamine, by inhibiting this enzyme, it raises the concentration of dopamine in CNS, thus more availability of dopamine, and it will act on its dopamine receptor. Benztropine is one of the anti-muscarinic drug. This drug has a role in Parkinson's disease by blocking the muscarinic receptors. There are some other drugs as well from the anti-muscarinic group, like trihexyphenidyl, benztropine, procyclidine. Amantadine, it is an antiviral drug. But besides its antiviral use, it is also used in patients of Parkinson's. The drawback of this drug is that amantadine, it is short acting, it is short lived, so it is not used as a monotherapy for treatment of Parkinson's disease. So amantadine, it increases the dopamine levels by increasing the release of dopamine, plus it has other mechanisms as well by inhibiting the reuptake of dopamine. Carbidopa is a drug which is not used alone. This is used in combination with levodopa to enhance the effects of levodopa. So carbidopa, it is this one is repetition. Carbidopa, it is not mentioned here. Carbidopa is inhibitor of, yes, peripheral dopa decarboxylase. It is inhibitor of peripheral dopa decarboxylase enzyme. So by inhibiting this enzyme, it inhibits the breakdown of levodopa into dopamine. So less peripheral metabolism of L-dopa, more dopa will enter into the CNS and it will be converted into dopamine, bringing about its effect on acting on its receptors. So these are the some drugs, some anti-Parkinsonian drugs with their mechanisms listed here. So another question that was discussed in my first lecture on anti-Parkinsonian drugs that is very important is carbidopa combination with levodopa. What are the advantages and what are the disadvantages? So advantages of carbidopa with levodopa are that by adding carbidopa to levodopa, the dose of levodopa is reduced up to 75%. This is the first advantage. Second one is that carbidopa addition can increase the efficacy of levodopa. It can increase the half-life of levodopa, and it can also reduce some of the peripheral side effects of levodopa like GIT side effects, nausea and vomiting that were caused by stimulation of chemoreceptor trigger zone. And the second side effect that is reduced due to this addition of carbidopa is cardiovascular side effects, arrhythmias. So in addition to this, the bigger disadvantage that is associated with this combination is that by adding carbidopa to levodopa, it can increase the behavioral effects and it can increase the schizophrenic-like symptoms due to higher concentration of dopamine in CNS. Because one of the hypotheses behind psychosis is higher concentration of dopamine in various areas of CNS. So to treat the psychosis, we use antipsychotic drugs which have the tendency to block dopamine receptors, thereby inhibiting the effects of dopamine. Now next is a true false. You have to say yes or no, and you have also to provide the reasons why you had said yes or no. Levodopa is not used with carbidopa as it increases the cardiovascular system and the GIT adverse effects. This is a wrong statement because carbidopa is not used alone. It is usually combined with the levodopa to decrease the cardiovascular and gastrointestinal side effects of levodopa. Monoamine oxidase B inhibitors are used in treatment of Parkinsonism. Yes, this is a true statement because selectively MAO B inhibitors like sertraline and resigeline, they are useful in Parkinson's. End of dose akinesia. This is one of the fluctuation response that is seen during therapy with a levodopa. This end of dose akinesia means the rigidity, it returns back at the end of dosing interval. So by increasing the dose and frequency of levodopa, this dose of akinesia can be relieved. So this is true. Fluctuation response caused by levodopa is aggravated by adding dopamine receptor agonist. So fluctuation response caused by levodopa is not aggravated by adding dopamine receptor agonist. This is a wrong statement. The addition of dopamine receptor agonist to levodopa, it can reduce the fluctuation response like on and off phenomena that occurs during levodopa. Apomorphine, it is used as rescue therapy for off period of akinesia. Just think about it, that apomorphine, it is one of the dopamine receptor agonist, and it has been used for the therapy of off periods of akinesia. And what is a significant side effect that occurs during the initial phase of administration of apomorphine? That is nausea. Yes, and how can we reduce this side effect? By pre-treatment with antiemetics. Dopamine receptor agonists do not need conversion for its actions in CNS. I will show you a diagram. As you can see here, that L-DOPA, after entering into the CNS, it needs conversion into dopamine by enzyme central DOPA decarboxylase. But unlike this, the dopamine receptor agonists like bromocriptine and pergolide, which are agar derivatives, and pramipexole and ropinirole, which are again newer non-agar derivatives, they will act directly on dopamine receptors. They do not need any conversion for its action. So dopamine receptors and agonists do not need conversion for its action. What are the other advantages of dopamine receptor agonists or levodopa? That by addition of dopamine receptor agonist to levodopa, the response fluctuation occurs with levodopa is reduced. They do not need any carrier for transport into the CNS. Dopaminergic drugs cause psychosis, and antipsychotic drugs that block D2 receptors do not cause Parkinson-like symptoms. So the first half of this statement, it is correct, because dopaminergic drugs, they cause psychosis, and the second half is incorrect because antipsychotic drugs that blocks D2 receptors, they cause Parkinsonian-like symptoms. So there are basically two categories of antipsychotic drugs. Those drugs having tendency or affinity for blocking D2 receptors, and the newer agents having less affinity for blocking D2 receptors, they are effective antipsychotics by blocking serotonin receptors. So D2 receptor antagonist antipsychotics, they can cause Parkinsonian-like symptoms, and the dopaminergic drugs, those drugs which increase the dopaminergic transmission or increase the concentration of dopamine in CNS, they can induce psychosis or schizophrenic-like symptoms. Last statement is entacapone, it can inhibit both central and peripheral COMT. So entacapone is a drug which is COMT inhibitor, but it inhibits only the peripheral COMT. So this is a wrong statement, because it has a capacity to inhibit only the peripheral COMT. Tolcapone is a drug which inhibits both central as well as peripheral COMT. Now the last slide is on, can you name some drugs or enlist some drugs that can induce Parkinsonism? I have repeated earlier as well that the dopaminergic drugs or anti-Parkinsonian drugs that increases the CNS concentration of dopamine, they can induce psychosis, and the antipsychotic drugs that are blocking D2 receptors, they can cause Parkinsonism. So antipsychotic drugs like haloperidol, another group of antipsychotics, phenothiazines, they also block D2 receptors. One of the antiemetic, metoclopramide, it is antiemetic, it also blocks D2 receptors and can cause EPS or Parkinson-like features. Rizerpine, which is an adrenergic neuron blocker, this is antihypertensive drug. And this drug, it by depleting the monoamines from their storage site, it can induce Parkinsonism. So these are some of the few drugs that can cause Parkinsonism. Antipsychotic drugs. You will also study this side effect of these antipsychotic drugs, specifically D2 receptor antagonist, in upcoming lectures. That they, when they are given for treatment of psychosis, they can cause EPS. EPS stands for extrapyramidal symptoms. So one of the category that is included in EPS is Parkinson-like syndrome. So these drugs, D2 antagonists, they can induce Parkinsonism. So this is the end of anti-Parkinsonian drugs. If you have any query regarding this chapter, you can ask me via email or in WhatsApp group. Thank you.